In a few days' time, we'll be commemorating Armistice Day in remembrance of the millions of lives lost 100 years ago in the First World War. This year, over 300,000 women will die in childbirth. That is more maternal deaths than Allied soldiers lost during the First World War each year. Now, the majority of maternal death is due to infection or bleeding at the time of childbirth. And the cost of preventing these deaths is that of training expert birth care attendants and organizing health care. Now, thankfully, the World Health Organization and other partner institutions have worked relentlessly, and maternal death has decreased by over 40% in the last 20 years to the levels that it is now. Today, I'd like to talk to you about preeclampsia, a condition responsible for 1 in 5 maternal deaths. That's a maternal death every 12 minutes somewhere in the world. Preeclampsia is a complication of pregnancy that results in very high blood pressure. Now, as a trainee obstetrician, your first encounter with preeclampsia can be quite traumatic. A perfectly healthy mother comes to our maternity unit accompanied by elated relatives, expecting and primed for a happy event. And the midwife puts on a blood pressure cuff as routine. But within minutes, you can see from her expression that things are not right. Her blood pressure is sky high. And despite our best attempts to control it, she becomes severely ill. And both her and her baby are admitted to our intensive care unit. Now, in many countries in the world, they would both have died. Now, it's left to me to explain why this catastrophe has occurred. And all I have by way of explanation is the same story that doctors have been repeating for 100 years. And that story suggests that something abnormal in the development of the placenta caused her high blood pressure to occur. And it's that story that I'd like to explore with you today. Preeclampsia was first described in 500 BC, and the medical features of the condition clearly documented about 100 years ago. And that documentation firmly believes that the placenta is central to the causation, because you have to have a placenta to develop preeclampsia. Now, the finding of tiny cellular lesions in the placenta down a microscope and the fact that the baby grows poorly in preeclampsia support the placental hypothesis. Presumably, the placenta can't feed the baby as well. Also, the fact that delivery of the placenta cures preeclampsia is taken as irrefutable evidence that the placenta causes preeclampsia. Now, I've been an obstetrician for over 25 years with a research interest in preeclampsia. Research that is embedded in the belief, or at least it was initially, that the placenta causes preeclampsia. Something that I've begun to regard with a different perspective. A perspective that challenges the prevailing medical opinion and beliefs. Now, we first realized that things were different when we started to look at how the mother responds in pregnancy. And we found that most women did not have anything wrong with their placenta. And in fact, their babies were normal in size or even larger than average. Now, those don't fit with the placenta working poorly. But what we could not take away was the fact that you have to have a placenta to develop preeclampsia, and that delivery of the placenta cured preeclampsia. And that seemed to be irrefutable until our research on the long-term health of our women. And that showed some interesting findings. Women who develop preeclampsia are 5 times more likely to develop heart disease or stroke in the subsequent 20 to 30 years. In fact, 2 out of 3 women who develop preeclampsia will die from heart disease. Well, here's a thought. How does the placenta that we disposed of 20 years ago have such a profound and serious effect on the mother's heart? Well, the problem with preeclampsia is that we really didn't know how to analyze this effect. And it seemed a conundrum that taking the placenta away cured the disease, but yet predisposed to long-term problems. And that seemed difficult and confusing until I started to see parallels with another disorder in pregnancy, and a disorder called gestational diabetes, where a mother develops diabetes as a consequence of the pregnancy. The mother's pancreas is unable to deal with the sugar load of pregnancy and can't produce enough insulin, the sugar-controlling hormone, and therefore diabetes occurs. Now, interestingly, diabetes in pregnancy is cured by the delivery of the baby. What's more, women who develop pregnancy diabetes have a 50% risk of developing diabetes themselves in the 10 years following pregnancy. I don't know about you, but it seemed logical to me to consider the possibility that preeclampsia had nothing to do with the placenta, but that preeclampsia represented a condition where the mother's heart was unable to deal with the vascular load of pregnancy. St. George's University of London, where I work, has a renowned sports cardiology center. Multidisciplinary team headed by Professor Sanjay Sharma, monitor and help our elite cyclists, rugby players, Olympians achieve their best performances. And they have all the best medical technologies available to them. And they're particularly interested in the performance of the heart. Now, for example, did you know that a young elite athlete who is setting out on a training program will increase the weight of her heart by 25% over a 2-year period? Now picture a pregnant mother. By 9 months of pregnancy, her heart mass has increased by 40%. Look at the little grooves in the heart. Those grooves are called trabeculations. Now, the number and the depth of these grooves are related to the amount of exercise you undertake. Here is a graph showing the prevalence of trabeculations in various elite sportsmen. Where do you think pregnancy comes there? Take a guess. Off the scale. So yet again, pregnancy outperforms our best and most elite sportsmen. To understand this, you need to realize that an Olympian may exercise for 10 hours a day, 5 days a week, but rest. A pregnant mother is working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for 9 months, and increasingly so as time goes on, with no rest, even when she's sleeping. And therefore, you've got to acknowledge that this is a truly Olympian achievement, okay? And pregnant women, our mothers, our partners, also deserve our respect for this. Now, we are not all Olympians, and therefore, it should come as no surprise to you that about 10 to 15% of women struggle to cope with the vascular load of pregnancy. Their heart comes under considerable strain. And evidence for this comes from reviewing the symptoms of pregnancy. Now, those of you who've been pregnant will recognize some of these symptoms: shortness of breath, swollen ankles, etc. I'm not getting much acknowledgement for the last one on the list. Perhaps I should ask your partners. Okay. But is it just a coincidence that the symptoms of heart failure are exactly the same? Well, when we look at the heart function in women who have pre-eclampsia, we find that it's quite deranged, in the same way that pancreatic function is deranged in women who develop diabetes in pregnancy. In fact, in the most severely ill pre-eclamptic women, the heart function that they have is similar to that of a 70-year-old woman. Now, we followed these women up for 1 to 2 years to chart their recovery, and were quite surprised to find little, if any, recovery over those 2 years. And that was shocking. So the question remained, what is the effect of preeclampsia on the mother's health? In order to tackle this, we developed a collaboration with Dr. Heather Boyd in the Staten Serum Institute in Denmark, and we followed up the postpartum health of 1 million Danish women. And what we found was that 20-year-old women who developed preeclampsia had the same risk of developing high blood pressure as a 40-year-old woman who had a normal pregnancy. So preeclampsia appeared to advance your age-related risk for heart disease by 20 years. It now seems totally absurd to me that I went around for 20 years saying that age and obesity and ethnicity were all risk factors for poor placental development and then preeclampsia, when it is obvious to us all that these are all risk factors for heart disease. Yeah? Now, if it's so obvious to us all, why did we miss it? And in order to understand that, you need to understand that the relationship between the heart and the placenta is very similar to the relationship of a pump and a radiator. For the radiator to work, it needs hot water pumped through it. And for the placenta to work properly, it needs the heart to pump oxygen and nutrients through it. And if the heart is not working properly, the placenta, which is a very oxygen-rich organ, will send out signals which makes the heart work harder and increase the blood pressure. The problem has been for us that when we looked into and wanted to investigate preeclampsia, we were left looking at the radiator, the placenta, and guess what? The pump had gone home with the mother. So what conclusion could we come to other than preeclampsia is a placental disorder? Because we simply failed to look at the pump. Now, I hope you'd agree that the evidence for the heart being involved and the cardiac origins of preeclampsia are quite overwhelming. Yet, we need to try and understand why the scientific community are finding it difficult to grasp this ideology. And I must admit, to being culpable as well. For many years, I was a believer in the placental origins and suffered from something called confirmation bias. That is a tendency to search for and interpret evidence to support my prior beliefs. Yeah? After all, we're asking them to throw away what they believed as the unshakable truth for 20 years, yeah, and accept a new paradigm. It's even worse when you challenge a researcher or a colleague and say that they have misinterpreted the evidence for 10 to 20 years. Yeah, that incites anger and rejection. It's far easier for me to collude with them and say that, actually, we haven't got much evidence, and that's why we haven't made any progress. And most important of all, research funding drives our research. And funding applications for money are reviewed by preeclampsia experts who believe in the placental origins and are less tolerant of other hypotheses. For example, a US institution recently awarded over $50 million looking at placental health in disease. Good luck with that. Now, where do we go from here? Understanding a disease is vital, whether it's preeclampsia or anything else, to help us cure and help. In preeclampsia, our diagnostic test is blood pressure, a technology that's 150 years old. I've seen a woman come to clinic in the morning with a normal blood pressure, be admitted later on that day with seizures from preeclampsia. And it's this inability to diagnose preeclampsia in a timely fashion that leads to women dying in a rural setting because they haven't got time to access healthcare. And only by understanding the disease can we begin to work on appropriate diagnostic tests that give us time. Our treatment for preeclampsia is scheduling birth. Preterm birth, being born early, is the leading cause of death under the age of 5, a million deaths a year. It's not until we understand and accept the cardiac origins of preeclampsia that we will begin to even scrape the surface of a treatment or prevention for the disease. Now, every woman has the right to safe childbirth. I fear that until the scientific community understands and accepts the cardiac origins of preeclampsia, that we will make no progress in reducing death and disease due to preeclampsia. What I hope is that we, doctors and scientists, could be a little bit more open-minded and see things from a different perspective, as you have done today. Thank you.